बिस्मिल्लाहिर्रहमानिर्रहीम डियर स्टूडेंट्स, टुडे वी विल स्टार्ट द सेवेंथ चैप्टर दैट इज रिलेटेड टू कमर्शियल बैंकिंग. फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल, व्हाट आर कमर्शियल बैंकिंग? एक्चुअली कमर्शियल बैंकिंग आर द सर्विसेज व्हिच आर बीइंग प्रोवाइडेड बाय योर कमर्शियल बैंक्स. And the general role of commercial bank is to provide financial services to general public or businessmen or certain other social and economic services to the economy of the country. Like for example, we can say that the commercial banking are there to create credit, and it is the most significant function of these commercial banks. Or they can also sanction loans to its customer, and they do not provide cash to the borrower. Instead, they open a deposit account from which the borrower can withdraw. In other words, while sanctioning a loan, they automatically create deposit. So these are different functions which are being provided by commercial banks, and the commercial banking services are one of the services which is being provided by these commercial banks. The importance of commercial banks, as I have already discussed, that commercial banks are the banks who provide different kind of financial services to the general public as well as to the government and any other business people who are doing business in the area in which that bank is operating. So this way they can play a very vital role in the development of the economy. First of all, the main function which is being provided by these commercial banks are they channelize idle cash. Like there are many people who have savings and they don't want to put that saving into a safe investment. So in that case, people can put their money into the bank, and bank can loan up these funds to the people who are actually desperately in need of funds, or they have skill, they have entrepreneurial skill, they have other type of business skill, but they are in short of fund. So bank can provide them loan, they can provide them these financial services to fill up this gap. Then, and obviously that money can be can play a vital role in economic development by contributing into the GDP of the economy. Secondly, they can create a demand deposit. As I am putting my money in the banks, so I at one and I am putting that money in a safe place. Other and I can take out that money at any time when I need them. So that these kind of deposits are called demand deposits, because these are the cash which are actually readily available for the people who have put that money into their bank accounts. So at one end, these monies are readily available to the people, and at the other end, bank as a risk management services, or bank apply their risk management services or risk management practices, and identify the daily cash they need for entertaining these demand deposit, and they can loan up the remaining amount to the people who desperately are in need of money. So in this case, at one end they can create demand deposit, on the other end they can facilitate different financial needs of the people. Thirdly, they can also facilitate trade, and they can facilitate trade in different ways. On one end, as a person want to indulge in trade related activities, and the person is in short of money, so they can go to the bank and get a loan from that. On the other hand, they can help them, they can facilitate trade by providing payment services to people. Like you have a bank in one country and branches in different other countries, or if you are doing national trade, or you are doing domestically buying and selling in different cities. So in that case also, you can make payment through these banking services, or making payment, online payment, or even cash payment, and any other type of payment through these banks. Then can also facilitate trade by providing the credit worthiness of their customer. On the basis of that, bank can provide the credit worthiness of their customer, or and people who want to do business with you be assured, because the bank has given a surety of your credit worthiness. So in this case, they can facilitate trade. Fourthly, it helps in payments and collection. like people have to do like in case of paying bills, in case of paying fees, in case of distribution salaries. So all these things are being facilitated by these banking services. Like now you can pay your children fees in the banks, or you can get your salaries through banks. So you can get the salaries through different ATMs and etc. So obviously it has, it can, the main, the vital role they are playing in by facilitating payments and collection. Next, they can issue letter of credits, traveler checks and circular notes. Like letter of credit actually is a letter which is being provided by the bank, and which it is actually a surety of the credit worthiness of the customer, and on the basis of which they can do business, or they can do trade with other businessmen, or in other countries or in other cities. And in traveler checks and circular checks are actually a kind of near money, or a kind of money which is not actually a money, but it can be representative money which can be used in different countries and different areas. Nextly, they can provide facility of foreign currency and exchange. Like obviously, if we need money, if foreign currency, so we can go to commercial bank and they can provide you currencies of different country. If and obviously they can exchange your currency with your foreign currency. So obviously they can provide you the facility of exchange facility of your currency by providing you foreign currency in exchange. Then a leasing facility. Nowadays the banks are also providing different customer service like leasing, and majority of times there are many Islamic banks, Islamic commercial banks, which are providing different consumer banking services on the basis of Islamic principles. Like a leasing is a kind of facility in which you can take loan, or actually get different items like a car or extra any or any other kind of automobiles and any other kind of machinery or etc. through which you can pay back in fixed installments. Then the bank can also issue demand drafts and pay orders, like making payments. Nowadays, it is demand drafts and pay orders are not common because there are ATMs are available, and secondly, there are online services are available, and Easy Paisa services and many other kind of payment services are available. So now they are not very common, but in the very start, when the banking services are there, so demand drafts and pay orders are the main way of transferring money from one area to another other areas. So these demand draft and pay orders are actually were used in transferring money from one area to another area. Like for example, when your children are in hostel, so you can pay them or you can send them money through pay orders and demand drafts. Or obviously they can provide a report on your credit worthiness of their customers. Like if you are operating a credit card facility or cash line facility or any other kind of overdraft facility with the bank, and you are paying your interest and other amounts on timely basis, so obviously they can pay, they can provide surety of your credit worthiness on the basis of which you can do business or trade or any other kind of activities with other people. So these are many important functions which are being provided by commercial banks. If we threats of commercial banking in Pakistan, like nowadays, if we look into the today's scenario, we don't see any kind of threats to these commercial banks, because nowadays these commercial banks are profiting and they are working very properly, and there are not such kind of threats which were which they were facing in the previous period. But there were times in which there were drastic reforms introduced by central bank, and that problem which created certain problems for commercial banks. And there are times when the commercial banks have to switch from the manual system to the digital system and to the online systems. So at that time there were different reforms which are being introduced by central banks, and many commercial bank have been have faced these problems at that times. But that they have now, if you look into the today's scenario, so many commercial banks are working properly and there are no potential threats which were faced, they are facing today. But the other problem which they are facing are continuous stagnation in economic activity. Like for example, due to COVID-19, there is very little economic activity world over, not only in Pakistan, world over. Secondly, there are many other aspects like the economic recession due to this COVID-19 and many other political problems, and the tax burdens and the IMF formalities. All these have impacted on the economic activity of the country, due to which because the commercial banks are there to facilitate economic activity, and if there is stagnation in the economic activity, the ETCAT had obviously create problems. Pakistan has faced this stagnation in economic activity problem since a very very long. Like we had a problem of terrorism, we had a problem of deficit trade and political instabilities. All these have obviously all these kind of thing has posed threats to commercial banks. The other problems which are like drive for accountability and loan recovery. Like in previous period, there were political influences on commercial banks, and these political leaders or political influential people have taken big loans from the different commercial banks and never paid back these loans. So obviously, if your loan is not recovered, so there is no reason for your existence, and obviously if you don't have money, how you can pay to the people from which you have taken money? So it can pose a threat to commercial banks. Other thing which has created a threat for commercial bank is a freezing of currency, foreign currency account. Like when Pakistan tested its nuclear bomb, so in that atomic bomb, so that time they freeze different foreign currency account in the country, because at that time there was a threat of flight of capital from Pakistan to other countries. So at that time, for the benefit or for retaining the foreign currency within the account, the government were compelled to freeze these currency accounts. So, but it has seriously damaged the trust of the people who have put their money in foreign currency accounts. So these are the major threats which can pose problems or which can hinder the services of commercial banks. Reasons for deficiency of capital accumulation in Pakistan. It's obviously a well identified fact that commercial banks will work if they have enough capital in their accounts, or if they can accumulate enough capital. But unfortunately, in Pakistan, we have many people who belong to low income group, and they are unable to fulfill their basic necessities. So how you can expect them that they will save money and put that money into bank? So this is the major reason. You have to increase the income of the people, and if the low income would be increased, so they will be in a position to put that money into bank, and that money would be used for capital creation and further for economic development. Other thing is we have wealth concentrated in few families. Back in the Bhutto's door, there were 22 families, but now we have 200 or 300 families in which these wealth is accumulated. And we have in Pakistan, the gap between the most poor people and the most rich people is increasing. And the middle income group is continuously decreasing. So this has posed a serious problem for capital accumulation. Then the main reason that people are not putting their money into bank accounts or in banks is Islamic concept. Like interest is prohibited in Islam, so people are not putting their money into banks, rather than they are purchasing property or investing in jewelries and any other unproductive things. And that is the main major reason that Islamic banking operations are drastically increasing in Pakistan. Many commercial bankers have introduced their Islamic banking branches. So they are now coming up the capital accumulation problem due to this is an Islamic concept. Then inefficient fiscal policy. In the previous period, due to political instabilities and the governments are actually coming out, coming in, going in, there were elections and obviously many other reasons due to which, personal reason due to which they will not, the fiscal policy was not designed very properly and many funds were taken from growth funds were taken to to very unnecessary things and many amount of money was spent on luxuries and any other things. So obviously it has poses serious problems on accumulation of capital. Then the other reason is that people are not are putting their saving into the bank account rather than they are putting their money in gold and property. Obviously, it's if you buy gold or property, so they were rather if you are buying property for commercial purposes, so they can it can take a little part in the economic stability or economic growth, but if you are putting in gold or buying gold and put that in your locker, so it has no economic use for the country. Now if we look into the growth of banking in Pakistan, so at the time of partition in 1947, the total bank in Pakistan were 38, in which only two banks were Pakistani, and there were 29 Indian banks, and the total deposit were rupees 800 million, and advances were rupees 198 million. And due to partition. And there obviously banks, the banking system was majorly controlled by non-Muslims because at that time also people were reluctant to indulge in banking activities due to interest and due to any other thing, and there were not much educated Muslims at that time. So obviously the majority of the banking system was controlled by non-Muslim, and the major problem were that many deposits were taken have to shift from Pakistan to India and from India to Pakistan. So and there were mass migration from on both sides. People are many Muslim people are coming from India to Pakistan, and from many Hindus and Sikhs were going from Pakistan to India, and these people all these people have bank accounts in India and Pakistan as well. So the major problem was that the banks have to shift money from one area to another area. And in Pakistan, because this banking system was dominated by non-Muslims, so many branches of banks who were operating in the areas which are included in Pakistan were closed, and large deposits were transferred from Pakistan to India after partition as well. So all these problems which causes a deadlock in the banking sector of Pakistan, because they don't have any sufficient fund, they don't have people who can perform these banking services, and they don't have enough branches, and many branches were closed down in Pakistan as well. So that created a deadlock in the very start when Pakistan came into being. So due to which, as there were banking services were at deadlock at the time of partition, so that time the authorities and administrations were on one page that they want to normalize these banking facilities, because if you want to stand up economically strong, or if you want to be stable economically, you have to restore banking facilities or normal banking facilities. So first of all, they have tried to create confidence and sense of security, because if people are putting their money into the bank, so they should have a security and confidence that their money would be in safe hands. and another thing they have provide them or they facilitate them banks were that they provide the banks were free to secure police protection because at that time there were robberies and loots and any other thing because there was mass migration and the people were very aggressive. Muslims and Hindus all were very aggressive. So at that time, bank has to seek the protection. So in this case, they were given free access to police, and that they, if at any time they want police protection, they can get that. And obviously, they allowed them a moratorium of 3 months to banks which have financial difficulties. As moratorium means that they have to stand still their current operation and normalize their operation. And because obviously, if they are in financial difficulties, so you have they give them moratorium is a period in which their operation will freeze. They will not do their normal operation. They use all their efforts to come up with their financial difficulties or any other problem which have. So at that time, the banks who have financial difficulties, so government have provided them 3 months moratorium for normalization of their financial difficulties or coming up or overcoming their financial difficulties. Nextly, each bank has to declare one of its office in India and Pakistan as clearing house. Like a clearing house is a services in which they can see that how much deposits are there of Pakistan of Indians in Pakistan and how much deposits of people who are in Pakistan are in India. So these banks were clear those things and obviously transfer those excess amount from India to Pakistan or from Pakistan to India, which are in excess or which are in less, whatever the case is. So the first thing that they have declared their offices in India and Pakistan as a clearinghouse because many depositors have to be transferred from Pakistan to India and India to Pakistan. So each bank has to open one central office in Pakistan where it could consolidate all its branches and start paying out to depositor. Like consolidate all its branches means that they have to establish one central branch which and all the other branches have to report to that that branch. Like so they can consolidate all the branches over there and they can start paying their depositor to the people who want their money back and provide banking training to Muslims. Obviously at the time of partition Muslims were reluctant to get a banking training and they were not willing to learn banking operations or they were not educated regarding business their banking services or banking areas. So the main concern is that now there are no Muslim people who have these banking information or training. So they have to train different Muslims to provide these banking facilities to those people. And secondly, it deals with complaints of Hindu banks as well because there are many people who have Hindu people who have their deposited in different banks in Pakistan. So they have to deal with all these complaints and allow removal of valuable by submission of application. Bank also provide locker facilities and many valuables were present in the lockers of different banks. So they also have given the facility that if they will provide application and they can provide evidence, so they can take their valuable as well, which are in their lockers. In order to normalize different banking services, an inter-dominion agreement of banking was signed between Pakistan and India, and this was done in April 1949. And the main purpose was that they want to transfer funds of Muslim from East Punjab to West Pakistan. And in case there were no branch of Muslim bank branch in Pakistan, deposit would be kept in a specific bank in Pakistan. Like they have to specify a specific bank and put that money in that specific bank in Pakistan. And in case of transfer of fund on own accord, like own accord means that I don't want to involve government to that. I just want to transfer that amount of money on my own. So in that case, the amount would be transferred to the original branch of the bank. Like if you have, you are transferring your money from HBL, so HBL, so you should transfer that money from the branch which is operating in India, from the branch which is operating in HBL branch which is operating in Pakistan. So in own accord, the specific bank can transfer money from its own branch to the other branch. The next is that Muslim in other state of India migrated to Pakistan can also transfer their deposit to Pakistan, because their main aim was that they want to transfer deposits from India to Pakistan and Pakistan to India. So the Muslim which are in other states of India and they are migrated to Pakistan, they can also transfer their deposit to Pakistan. And bank who want to close their business in Pakistan have to keep equal amount of outstanding liabilities. Like outstanding liabilities is that if they have taken money from the people and they are liable to pay that. So if they want to close their branches, so have the equal amount of outstanding liabilities that which have they have to pay, and they can close their branches as well. Or banks provide certain facility for easy disposal of stock pledged with them. Obviously, bank provide loan on by pledging different securities, and the people are going bad. So bank has also given them facility that they can dispose of their stock which were pledged with them by making certain payments. Or deposit invested with cooperate with bank were also be transferred. So all these were decided in the inter-dominion agreement between Pakistan and India. There are many banks which are working in Pakistan and which can be divided on the basis of like there are certain scheduled bank and there are non-scheduled bank, and the scheduled bank are those banks which whose reserve are not less than 2 million, and they are actually member of clearing house of SPP. Like they can get clearing house facility through State Bank of Pakistan, and their statutory cash requirement is 7%, and they have to submit weekly and monthly reports about their financial position as well. There are many non-scheduled banks which are working in Pakistan, and these their minimum weight of capital are 50,000 and not more than 500 million, and they are not a member of clearing house of State Bank of Pakistan. And if you look into different commercial banks, so at the time of partition, there were three major type of banks which were operating in Pakistan. Like there were Pakistani commercial bank, which were were only two, and there were many foreign commercial banks, and there were Indian commercial bank as well. Because foreign commercial bank was there because at that time Britishers were working in Pakistan, and there are many foreigners like foreigners which are in Pakistan. So obviously they have also opened their foreign bank as well. So these British and other banks were also working in Pakistan, and the Indian commercial banks were also there at the time of partition. In Pakistan nowadays, if we look, we have different type of banks. Like there are national banks. These are the banks which are working under the government, and they are like most of the activities like payment to the salaries of the government employees and paying pension to government employees, and all these services are being provided by these national banks. And obviously a different kind of payment and collection, because these national banks are working for a state bank, and all the commercial banking activities are of government are being done by these national banks. And there are many private banks, or we can say commercial banks, which are working. There are many cooperative banks, there are many agricultural bank, industrial development bank, and small and medium enterprises bank which are working in Pakistan. So these are different type of banks. Like small and medium enterprise banks are specifically providing loan facilities and other facilities to small and medium enterprises. And there are different industrial development banks which are providing loans facilities to different industries, or facilitating working of these industries. And there are agriculture bank who are specifically providing loans and other facilities to agriculture sector of the country. Like cooperative banks actually are those banks which are working in specific areas, and these are the banks which take deposits from that area and provide and loans for the development of that area. So these are cooperative banks who are working in Pakistan. Then private banks which are actually providing commercial services as well, and obviously we have discussed this national bank which are providing certain commercial facility, commercial banking facilities to the government. Like principles of sound banking, like means that if you are if you want to open a commercial bank, or if you want to see that how an efficient commercial banking session should be performed, so for these are different principles which can help you to perform good banking system, banking facility, or perform good banking services. Like first of all, a licensed, you have to get licensed for performing commercial banking services within in an area. And secondly, reasonable high paid-up capital. You cannot work without money when you are operating a commercial bank. So you must have a reasonable high paid-up capital when you are starting your commercial banking. And thirdly, maintain minimum reserves. Banks are there to perform financial and to perform a financial intermediary services, like taking money from the savers and give them to the investor. But on other hand, they have to put a certain amount of minimum reserve to fulfill daily and many daily, monthly, or yearly demands of money which of their depositors. So they have to maintain minimum reserve as well, because they don't have they don't want to fail to meet the requirements or meet the demands of their customer who have put their money into their demand deposits. Fourth, balanced growth in rural and urban areas. If you want to perform a sound banking system, so in that case, the government or central bank has to see that the loans which are provided by these commercial banks are equally given to urban and rural areas, and these are actually equally distributed, and because the development of both areas are important for the economic development of the countries. Then adopt new banking operation. Like in this technological era, it's very important that the banks should adopt new practices, and they should adopt new operations as well. Like if you see all the banks in Pakistan are now on digital basis, and they are performing online services. So obviously, if you will not adopt the new technology, so you will be thrown out of the market, because you are doing business. If you are doing commercial banking, so obviously you are doing business and you are earning profit. So it's important that you should adopt new practices which are prevalent in the market. Then safeguard loan by valuable securities. This is actually related to your risk management procedures. The bank should see that they are giving loan to proper people, and if they are give you mortgages, or if they are taking loan through different pledges, or if they are pledging their valuables like different merchandise and etc. So you have to see that these are of proper quality, and you have to perform all your risk management practices while giving these loans. Training is very important, because with the passage of time, your banking services are emerging, new banking trends are emerging, and new practices are emerging. So obviously you have to provide a training to your staff as well. Then use information technology. It is actually included in training. Must be competitive now, because you are working as a business concern, so you must be competitive. You have to see that what are your services which are more better than your competitor, and you have to improve your services continuously. You have to improve work on the quality of services you are providing, and must embark upon program of intellectual capital formation, because you are as a commercial banking service service provider, you are the people who create credit. So you have to adopt new procedures, new kind of activities through which you can form more and more of capital.